Good evening, everyone. Welcome to UT Southwestern Science Café. We're glad to have you join us on this special night. Welcome. My name is Jenny King, and I'm Director of Public Affairs at UT Southwestern. And on behalf of my colleagues, Mindy Sass, Charlandra Thompson, and our guest speaker, Dr. Robert Timmerman, thanks for joining us. Science Cafés are online conversations where speakers take you on deep dives into science. We want us to have fun while we learn. The format is casual and interactive with speakers from UT Southwestern and occasional invited special guests. We encourage you to ask questions and engage with us during this program. This evening, we'll be discussing PULSAR, Personalized Medicine for Cancer Treatments, with Dr. Timmerman. PULSAR is a great example of the intersection between patient care and technology, including artificial intelligence. Before we begin, we want to review a few technical matters, so here we go. We are recording this program as well as live streaming it tonight on our UT Southwestern Twitter page. Please mute your microphones to help with audio clarity for everyone, and just unmute your call on to ask a question. We encourage you to utilize the chat feature to list questions for Dr. Timmerman. We will call on audience members to ask their questions following his presentation. Mindy Sass will be facilitating Q&A tonight, and Charlandra Thompson and I are working behind the scenes to monitor your questions. And finally, just a reminder, while we cannot answer personal medical questions, we would love to hear from you with general questions. And with that, I am pleased to introduce our presenter. Dr. Robert Timmerman is professor, vice chair, and medical director of the Department of Radiation Oncology, as well as professor of neurosurgery. After earning a master's degree in reactor physics, he completed medical school in his home state of South Dakota, followed by a residency in radiation oncology at Johns Hopkins. Dr. Timmerman's career has focused on precise medicine to treat patients. Early on, he specialized in treating brain tumors and other cranial abnormalities with devices like the Gamma Knife, which is an extremely precise, non-invasive radiosurgical tool. His work continued with developing a method known as SAbR, by which it was possible to account for movement and still safely deliver treatments. And tonight, he is going to be discussing the latest in precision medicine called PULSAR. Dr. Timmerman currently directs training courses in stereotactic radiotherapy, both at UT Southwestern and nationally for members of the National Radiation Therapy Oncology Group. He is a highly sought-after guest speaker and has authored or co-authored numerous peer-reviewed articles and textbooks. With his patients, he continues to focus on diseases of the central nervous system, including cancer of the brain and spine, as well as lung cancer. He also specializes in seeing children and young adults who are still growing, those for whom extremely precise treatment is likely to result in better long-term quality of life. Welcome, Dr. Timmerman. The virtual podium is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate this opportunity to talk to you about sort of our newest innovation in radiotherapy that might couple itself better with the other cancer treatments as well. So I think we'll start with a quiz. Sort of mean to do that, but we'll start with a quiz about, does anybody in the audience know what PULSAR stands for? And if you could just use the polling feature here that's in front of you, we'll just give a second for people to take a stab at what they think PULSAR stands for. It's an acronym. Looks like this was an easy question.
We're halfway there on voting. We'll end it in about 4 seconds. Okay, I'm going to end the polling, and the results are indeed.
Well, that's great. And the acronym was devised by one of the junior faculty here at UT Southwestern. And he was an immunologist that is treating patients with radiation as well. But it's personalized ultrafractionated stereotactic adaptive radiotherapy. And I hope by the end of this discussion, we'll all understand why that acronym is appropriate. Personalized medicine is sort of the opposite. I'm going to try to get the screen to move on. For some reason, my screen's not moving. I'm having a technical problem here. Personalized therapy is sort of the opposite of one size fits all therapy. And you know, whether the therapy is too much or too little, I think we'd all agree that it's not so ideal if it's one size fits all. And cancer therapy, I'm sad to say, is sometimes one size fits all as well. In other words, you sort of are allowed only one choice off the menu. And it reminds me of the old Saturday Night Live skit where people went into the restaurant and tried to order what they wanted and all they could have was a cheeseburger. But if you had, for example, lung cancer, this is the options that you get. If you're stage one, you get surgery. If you're stage two, you get surgery. If you're stage three, you get 6 degrees of radiation therapy. You get chemotherapy with a platinum derivative and you get immunotherapy. If you're stage four, you get platinum chemotherapy and immunotherapy. So if you were a patient with minimal volume stage three, you still get that full array of treatments. And if you're a patient with one tumor versus a whole bunch of tumors, metastatic in stage four, you still get the same treatment. And so it's clearly a sort of a one size fits all off the menu. And here's an example of what I'm talking about. This is a patient with a tumor in the sinus with the arrow pointing to the tumor. This is a tumor in the sphenoid sinus before and after treatment. And it was a good response. The tumor pretty much disappeared. In contrast that to this patient who had another sinus tumor, again with the arrow pointing to it, they both get the same therapy. In the case of the second patient, there's a poor response. And we didn't learn that until along the way. That is, one does well and one does not so well, but you didn't know that up front that was going to happen. So the obvious question to ask is, did the first patient get overtreated? And did the second patient get undertreated, again, with the same therapy in both cases? And personalization in 2021 for cancer therapy is mostly based on genomic sequencing. And this is a kind of exciting new way to look at tumors and try to identify unique aspects of a given patient's tumors. And it identifies mutations. It compares the genome of the cancer, which, by the way, derived from the patient, and compares it to the normal genetic profile within the patient from their normal cells. And if it identifies mutations, they could constitute vulnerabilities, particularly to a class of drug therapies. And so if it's an EGFR mutation, you might use an EGFR drug, et cetera. But still, even with this approach in 2021, if patient A does well and patient does not do well, this whole approach is upfront and it ignores response along the way. And sadly, surgery and radiotherapy, which are the other big cancer fighters, remain one size fits all therapy, even if the drug therapy is personalized. And that's sad because surgery and radiotherapy are the most curative therapies. So I'm going to contrast, just so we're all on the same page, the difference between systemic therapies and local therapies. Systemic therapies include things like chemotherapy, targeted therapy, immunotherapy, whereas local therapies are surgery, radiotherapy, and ablative radiology like RFA. Systemic therapies go all over the body, sparing the sanctuary sites like your brain, whereas local therapies are directed or aimed at a specific target. Systemic therapies are new and cutting edge. You're hearing about them all the time on the news, whereas local therapies have been around for over 100 years. Systemic therapies are based on science, very cutting edge science, whereas local therapies are mostly based on experience. Systemic therapies can be very expensive. A course of immunotherapy per year might be $120,000. Whereas local therapy is not cheap, but considerably less expensive than those drug therapies. And systemic therapies are delivered by a medical oncologist, whereas local therapies are delivered by butchers and bakers. So your butcher would be the surgeon, and your baker would be the flamboyant radiation oncologist. In the end, though, each of these therapies has its strengths, but sadly, they're somewhat poorly integrated. And again, we're hoping that we can do something better. Now, I want you to all close your eyes and tell me, when you think of radiotherapy, what do you think of? Well, actually, nobody thinks about radiotherapy. It's common, but it's not so sexy. Surgery is more sexy. In fact, the surgeon comes out to the waiting room after the case and tells the family, "I got it all," and everybody gasps. In contrast, radiotherapy mops up after surgery. In other words, the surgeons really didn't get it all. There's still some microscopic crumbs hanging around. And so radiotherapy has mostly been mopping up after surgery. So if you see that guy pushing the bucket behind the horse, that's me. That's the kind of doctor that I am. And radiotherapy has classically been a very slow course, very inconvenient, come day after day after day for 6 to 8 weeks to complete a course of therapy. That's even for smaller tumors. And we do it that way because a little bit every day seems to be less toxic than giving all the dose up front. And yet after 6 to 8 weeks, it's still quite toxic. I'm gonna go back in time a bit. And in between 1970 and 1990, because of the toxicity of radiotherapy, investigators thought it would be prudent to put a break in the middle of the course. So that's called a split course. And the whole point of it was to reduce toxicity. And that's similar to why they don't give chemo all in one big dose. They give you some and then they wait till your blood counts recover. And then that might be 3 weeks or a month. And then they'll give you another cycle of chemotherapy. It's the same idea. So an example of a split course radiotherapy would, instead of giving 60 gray and 30 daily fractions, which would take 6 weeks, Monday through Friday, 5 days a week, they'd give half of that, 30 gray and 15 treatments, then give a 2 week break, and then follow that by the completion of the 30 gray and another 15 treatments, and it should be less toxic. It was a great idea, but sadly it didn't work. And we sort of were stubborn about giving up on the idea. Indeed, it was less toxic. It was clearly less toxic that if you put a split in the course, it was less toxic. But unfortunately, the tumor liked it better too. And so the tumor would either recover or even proliferate during the break. So it achieved what it was set out to do, but the tumor liked it better. And there was a tumor control penalty, an increased number of recurrence, at least with this type of therapy, with the little dose every day over many, many days. At about the same time that the death of the split course idea occurred was the birth of this new treatment that was described in the intro called SAbR. And SAbR is stereotactic ablative radiotherapy. It's almost the polar opposite of conventional radiotherapy. Instead of treating a broad field, trying to mop up crumbs, this was a treatment that was focused against gross tumors and tried to take advantage of technologies that would allow you to understand the motion of tumors, to modulate the dose, and to guide the beams with each treatment. So a host of technologies were used to deliver these SAbR treatments. And instead of 30 treatments, it might be 3 treatments. And they were typically still, though, given every day without a split. So you'd get one on maybe Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, or Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, but there was no split in the course. And this was a favorable experience. We've now been able to treat patients with early stage lung cancer and other cancers with a much more curative approach. So that was about in the 1990s and early 2000s. What's hot right now in 2021 for radiotherapy is a concept called adaptation. And in fact, there's great opportunities now to spend money on expensive machines that combine an MRI scanner with a linear accelerator, machines that even combine PET scanning with a linear accelerator. And we actually have all of these machines being installed as we speak in this new expansion to the right of our facility. This is our adaptive wing. And so we're putting so much interest into this approach that we've even built a building that houses the machines that do it. Now, what adaptation means is to respond to change. And most often that change would relate to, for example, a tumor shrinking. So the initial radiotherapy plan is for a big tumor, and your hope is that during the course of the treatment, the tumor will shrink and allow you to treat a smaller volume. Or conversely, maybe the normal tissues would move because of different things that occur. Maybe the bowel gas is more on one day than another, or maybe the bladder is more full on one day or another. And so these are adaptations to position, day-to-day variations in the position of the patient on the table, or adaptations to shape, that is, did the tumor shrink or not? And in this example, you can see the in red outlined is the initial tumor, it shrunk. And so now you're treating a bigger volume than necessary. And in addition, the skin, which was outside the field initially, is now inside the high dose field. So both of these would be a prudent thing to do. Now I'll say though, these machines have been around now for a couple of years, adapting to position and shape, but it hasn't really made a big impact on patient outcomes. There's so much very more potential than just adapting to position and shape, and I'll get into this. So the Achilles heel of this adaptive radiotherapy, especially when given with the small daily doses over many, many weeks, is that really nothing changes that much during the course of a therapy like that. So adapting to shape doesn't really happen, because the whole point of giving little daily doses, as has been done for the last many decades, is about tiny, hard to notice nudges, not significant changes. And to give you an example of what I'm talking about, let's say we wanted to adapt to the way that Jennifer Aniston changed from age 20 to age 50. Well, she really hasn't changed much in that period of time. So there's really nothing to adapt to. And that's the same problem that we have with conventional radiation. Now, contrast that to considering Mick Jagger. Here's Mick Jagger at age 20. Here's Mick Jagger at age 50. Now, the obvious adaptation that you would make is to recommend a facelift and a lip injection. And this is something then, this big amount of change could be a true adaptation that would make a big difference. And so we're after big changes, ideally. And that brings us to the concept of PULSAR. PULSAR is a new radiotherapy. It actually abandons the conventional fractionation altogether by using the technologies to give large standalone treatments, SAbR-like treatments that wouldn't have that tumor control penalty that we discussed before. But specifically, these pulses are separated in time purposely by at least a week and perhaps even months. So instead of getting a treatment on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, you get a treatment in January, February, and March. And if that variable to take advantage of that degree of freedom allows, hopefully there'll be a big change in between those pulses. So there are three attractions to this PULSAR. First of all, it is a split course treatment, and we already proved that split course treatments are less toxic. So for the same dose, and again, this has been shown in many randomized trials, the treatment will be less toxic if you split it. So we could use it then for tumors near toxicity prone locations, like a tumor next to your esophagus or something like that. Second, there's the long intervals between the pulses would facilitate an adaptation that was more meaningful, allowing big changes to occur from one pulse to the next. And so we would use it for big tumors, or ideally move toward an even more comprehensive personalization of all cancer therapy. And then finally, and this is most controversial, long intervals between pulses might foster what we call adaptive immunity. Adaptive immunity is like a vaccine. And to complete the cascades required for a vaccine, there's a lot of time that's required. And hopefully then we could combine PULSAR with the exciting systemic immunotherapies that you might have heard about. So let's just explore each of these briefly. Split course treatments are less toxic. Here's a study that was done in Canada where costs of medical care is very important to them. And they were trying to reduce the cost with hypofractionated radiation, just giving five treatments for prostate cancer. And they were using a regimen that we developed about a decade ago, using 8 gray times 5, or 40 gray and 5 fractions. And again, they compared the standard treatment that was developed every other day treatments compared to separating each treatment by a week. So this is PULSAR separated by a week. And indeed, it improved the acute urinary and bowel toxicity. It was less toxic. But more importantly, by giving these big doses per treatment instead of the gentle fractionation, there was no difference in cure rate. The PSA control rate was the same in both of these arms, even with mature follow-up. So there was no tumor control penalty. Now, the second advantage of PULSAR would be that long intervals might facilitate adaptation. So let's say we started out with a tumor, and I'm making a cartoon here, but a tumor that's colored red here. You give the first pulse, and sadly, the tumor grows. That's important information. If a tumor is so aggressive that it grows after a pulse, you might need to change your plan. So let's say you enlarge the volume because it got bigger, you increase the dose, and you maybe even add a sensitizer like chemotherapy or something like that. And then finally you get it to start to shrink, and you continue to do these pulses a month apart or so. And at the end you realize, I don't see it anymore, but it possibly could still be there because it was such an aggressive treatment. So I might add a drug for consolidation. And then contrast that to a patient whose tumor actually does shrink after the first pulse. You might reduce the volume, of course, and also decrease the pulse dose and continue the therapy. If everything goes well, you might stop after 4 pulses instead of 5 and not use an adjuvant drug therapy. Now, this is all based on shape. That is, did the tumor shrink or grow? And it makes a logical sort of a treatment approach, and it's much more personalized. But there's so much more we could consider as indicators of whether we should continue the therapy or do it differently, including molecular, biological, and organ factors. And what I mean by that is the tumor can be characterized by sort of 3 realms. First of all, the tumor itself, its histology, its mutational burden, its immune signaling, like if it's a treatment likely to use immunotherapy with. You can also look at the tumor microenvironment, whether what kind of cells infiltrate around the tumor, how good is the blood supply to the tumor? Is it well oxygenated or hypoxic? And then finally, what kind of a patient are you treating? Is it a healthy patient? Is it a weak patient? Is it metastatic or localized? What kind of things are circulating in the blood, tumor markers, or circulating DNA or the likes? Now, all this combination and permutation of information could get complicated very quickly, but if you could use it in a way that would guide the therapy, that is a directive that could either tell us to continue the therapy, intensify the therapy, or de-intensify the therapy along the way. This is so complicated, but it's a perfect problem for machine learning to try to find solutions, to try to find signatures and directives. And machine learning, of course, is artificial intelligence. And another potential situation would be, let's say you started with a patient who had metastatic cancer with 4 tumors. You start them on the standard of care systemic therapy, do a series of interrogations to understand what that patient is like at baseline, and treat all 4 of these tumors, trying to get long-term survival. Let's say that 1 tumor disappears, 2 of them shrink, but 1 of them grows after the first pulse. You might do a dual PET to try to characterize why that 1 tumor grew and the others didn't. Adapt to the shape and volume again and add more treatment. Now a new tumor appears. You might want to biopsy that new lesion to see if it's the same sort of genetic profile as the other lesions. And then keep moving on, hoping again to get a better outcome and a more personalized therapy than what we've done in the past. And then finally, again, controversial, is that long intervals between pulses might foster adaptive immunity. And the way that a treatment like radiation could foster immunity is by a vaccination effect. That is, you treat the tumor is trying to hide the unique features of it from our own immune system, because cancer, after all, is a failure of the immune system to destroy something that's been mutated. What happens is that dendritic cells, which are specialized blood cells, take up unique tumor antigens after it's been irradiated. And then they leave the tumor. They go through the lymphatics to a lymph node where they potentially meet up with a T cell that has an antigen specific to that particular tumor. And then those T cells are activated by the dendritic cells, proliferate, and then the T cells come back to the tumor to try to fight it. That's basically a T cell response like a vaccination. And so we've talked a lot about COVID in the last year and the vaccinations associated with COVID. This is one aspect of the vaccination that works best against cancer. But it takes these cascades days or weeks to occur. And again, this is effectively a vaccination. Now, if you're trying to vaccinate somebody for like an infectious disease like COVID, how are vaccinations typically given? Well, they're not given daily or every other day, like radiotherapy has been done for decades. Instead, you get initial inoculation, followed weeks or months later by booster shots. And so here's the schedule for childhood immunizations. You can see that they're all separated by some time. And the reason they do that is because this is the most effective way to vaccinate somebody. And so the if you do a SAbR inoculation up front, the first pulse, followed weeks or months later by SAbR boosters, that's exactly what PULSAR is. So it just starts out logical that PULSAR might work better with the immune system than the current way we're doing things. But that's a lot to say. So we partnered with the people in our laboratories to do some preclinical work in mice models and see if this hypothesis might be true. And so what was done was mice were injected with a tumor, and they were either treated with immunotherapy, an anti-PD-L1 drug, or an isotype, which is basically a control. And this particular tumor is a very aggressive tumor called Lewis lung cancer, and it's immunologically not very reactive to the immune system. And indeed, when you gave that drug therapy, that immunotherapy, to these animals, it had no impact whatsoever on the growth rate of tumors. So that first column shows the tumor and controls growing at the same rate. If you add radiotherapy a day apart, like it's conventionally given with radiotherapy every day, the radiotherapy has an impact on the tumor growth. But again, if you add the immunotherapy to the situation, there's no benefit to the immunotherapy. Same is true if you separate them by 4 days. But very interestingly, if you separate the two radiation treatments by 10 days, sort of like PULSAR, all of a sudden the immunotherapy, which was totally useless by itself or in combination with daily or every other day treatments, starts to work. And so what we're finding is that the time split between doses of radiotherapy will predict whether or not a drug therapy will work or not in the situation. And so if they're 10 days apart, the drug therapy helps a lot. If they're 1 to 4 days, it doesn't help. And ironically, all the clinical trials that are being done right now with radiotherapy and immunotherapy are using a day apart or every other day apart. And so probably the exact wrong timing to use for immunotherapy. And we went on to find out that indeed, this was a vaccination effect. It was T cell dependent. And it also created a vaccination effect where the patient had memory to the tumor. So we injected a tumor, and if the animals cleared that tumor and then we re-injected the same tumor, that tumor didn't grow. So there was a memory similar to an adaptive vaccination effect. So now I'm just going to show you some clinical examples in real humans of this PULSAR effect. This is a patient with metastatic kidney cancer coming from far out of town. They're coming from Baltimore. And they have a large tumor here right next to this airway. I don't know if you can see my mouse moving, but there's a small airway that's a black dot right to the left of this big tumor outlined in red. These are the radiotherapy fields treating that tumor. The patient also got a tyrosine kinase inhibitor. This one didn't have any immunotherapy. We gave a pulse and then waited 3 weeks. And what we found was that the tumor started out very big, but with each pulse, the tumor got progressively much smaller, such that after two pulses, the tumor now has gone from 68 cc's to 3 cc's. And you can imagine it's way less toxic to treat a 3 cc tumor versus a 68 cc tumor. So this is an example of trying to avoid toxicity with PULSAR. This is an example of a really bad brain tumor called glioblastoma in a young person who had been treated with all standard options, and all the treatment options were exhausted. They put her on nivolumab, which is an immunotherapy, and it didn't work. This white tumor that I'm pointing at with my mouse grew while she was on nivolumab. So nivolumab by itself doesn't work. But we add PULSAR to the nivolumab, do 5 pulses. Nivolumab is scheduled every 3 to 4 weeks, so we just followed that schedule. And that tumor just disappeared with that therapy. So this is a combination of PULSAR with immunotherapy. And this is an interesting example, a recent patient who had a large saddle tumor, a cardiac sarcoma. It looked like an embolus, a saddle embolus. This is this dark wishbone-shaped tumor inside the great vessel. This is the pulmonary artery. They were taken for emergency surgery because it was blocking the outflow of the heart. And twice the patient went for emergency surgery. Each time the tumor recurred quickly, and it got worse in that not only was there now tumor in the pulmonary artery blocking the outflow of the heart, but a lot of lymph nodes around the heart and even some tumors in the left lung that were called tumor emboli. Now the patient's in right heart failure because they can't get blood out of their heart and they have a tumor blocking the pulmonary artery. So we did a novel treatment where we decided to treat the worst offender, the tumor in the pulmonary artery, with PULSAR. So we only treated that because to treat everything would have been quite toxic, and then put the patient on that same drug, that nivolumab, which is an immunotherapy with each pulse. Now, interestingly, the tumor that we aimed at with the PULSAR didn't change much. The patient still had outflow obstruction, but all the other tumors just started to melt away. The circled here is a lung tumor that shrunk and all the lymph nodes shrunk too. But since the patient was still in right heart failure because of the obstruction, the patient decided to go on hospice. But 2 weeks after the second pulse, the patient starts to feel much, much better. The heart failure has resolved. We re-image, and now that tumor in the pulmonary artery, which has got this line measuring it here, went from 60 millimeters to 50 millimeters, but enough room for blood to get around it. Patient comes off hospice and is now getting further treatment with this approach. And you can see the red arrow showing this big lymph node getting dramatically smaller, even though it wasn't targeted with the PULSAR. So this is an abscopal effect, an effect that's caused by the immune system. So we've developed a number of protocols for PULSAR in different disease sites. It could be used for any potential disease site and for the various reasons that I discussed. And so what's next? So the promise of PULSAR is that the initial pulses will inform the subsequent pulses, give a directive as to how to change the therapy. So they might be different doses, different volumes, combined with different co-therapies like immunotherapy or targeted therapy or surgery, maybe abandon the treatment altogether. And it requires knowledge of best how to react to patient-specific change. And so it's a whole bunch of data, biomarkers, creating validated signatures to tell you what to do next. And again, it's a very complicated amount of information that would be perfect for artificial intelligence. So what I've just described is sort of a pie in the sky. But what we've done to move forward is, first of all, we've formed a PULSAR interest group of clinicians, lab researchers, physicists. We're implementing registries. We've developed the prospective trials that I just mentioned, and we've come up with a buffet of potential interrogations to mine and help direct PULSAR based on the tumor microenvironment, and the host. We're building infrastructure to store all this data, both hardware and software, so that we can eventually mine it and determine the directives. And we're implementing AI-based analysis to try to understand and decide what to do next. So sort of in conclusion then, radiotherapy is a very old therapy. It's over 100 years old, been fairly lackluster for most of its history, needs to reinvent itself and tap into its potential and abandon fractions for pulses. And PULSAR has three potential benefits: less toxic at the same dose, facilitates true adaptation or personalization of the therapy for each patient along the way, and may interact with immunotherapy more optimally. So this new radiotherapy, we were previously forced by poor technology to fractionate. Now, good technology is allowing us to pulse. You give at least two pulses separated by ample time, take advantage of this degree of freedom, this new variable. And one pulse is okay, but you can adapt if you give more than one. You interrogate the abundant change that occurs over time, and it's a legitimate implementation of medical artificial intelligence, and exploit the many opportunities presented by this pulsing. Finally, to get an adaptive treatment that's personalized and hopefully more interaction with immunotherapy. And I'd like to acknowledge different people who have helped get us this far. We've got a long way to go, but I think we've made some progress, and I'm now happy to take questions.
Awesome, thank you, Dr. Timmerman. So it looks like we've got a few questions that are coming in via the chat. Sorry, I'm getting an echo. Carol, Bass, if you'd like to ask your question, go ahead and unmute yourself.
Hi, I actually mistyped. I asked my question actually right when you were at the beginning of your talk. And I was just wanting you to explain photon versus proton therapy, please.
Dr. Timmerman, I think you might be muted.
I struggle with technology. So there's different types of radiation. There's photons, which are either X-rays or gamma rays. Gamma rays are naturally decaying radioactivity, and X-rays are man-made electromagnetic waves. And they start on the skin and deposit most of the dose on the skin and then sort of peter out as they go through the tissue. If you use many, many beams, the skin dose can be very low, and you can converge the beams to get a high dose in one spot. It's very well described. We know exactly how much dose goes into the patient with this approach. And so it's been around for a long time. Protons are charged particles. They're positively charged particles that can be directed into tissue. They have a different sort of behavior where they don't deposit most of the dose in the skin. They go into the tissue, depositing some dose, and then all at once they give up their energy in what's called a Bragg peak. So there's advantages to protons in avoiding exit dose. And protons are, I think, exciting ways to deliver therapies to get at least less exit dose. Problems with protons are that the machines to generate them are very expensive, and the characterization of the actual dose delivered is more difficult. And so there's been some problems with protons overdosing an area that was unintended. Eventually we'll get the handle on that, but it's a more modern therapy that still needs to get some kinks out of it. But both of them are forms of radiation. At the point of the tumor, they're the same. So if you give the same dose of protons, it's relatively the same as the same dose of photons with just minor variations.
Thank you for your question, Carol. The next question we've got, it looks like, is coming in from Gina. Gina, would you like to unmute and ask your question? Let's see, I'll give her a moment.
Hi, Dr. Timmerman. My question was, based on the data collected thus far on PULSAR ART, treatment, what stage do you anticipate would benefit the most from this type of treatment regimen?
So I'm excited because I think any stage could benefit. I mean, I think any stage could benefit for more personalization. And now there are patients who have metastatic cancer who just have too many tumors to treat, went to treat all of them. But I think I try to show you that example where we didn't treat all the tumors. We only treated some to get the vaccination effect. And that then the immune system can potentially treat tumors that we didn't aim at specifically with the focused radiation. So it could be any stage. And you know, when we first introduced SAbR, which is this, you know, very focused stereotactic radiation, we targeted mostly early stage patients. And it's taken us a while, but we're finally doing metastatic patients. But PULSAR, I think, could treat any of the spectrum of stages. And I think it could treat almost any cancer types too.
Thank you for your question, Dina. Looks like we have a question from Subara Yudu. I'm hoping I said that correct. If you want to unmute and ask your question, please do. Give them a moment to unmute. Okay. We can come back to you if you're able to unmute later on. Wendy had a question. Wendy, if you are here, would you like to unmute and ask your question?
Sure. I was just curious, what is UT Southwestern doing currently in terms of what kind of cancer are they using PULSAR to treat, or is this still in the stage of research and development?
That's a great question. And we're developing small pilot studies, you know, 20 to 40 patients to treat a variety of tumors. We have lung cancer, brain metastasis, cervix cancer, pancreatic cancer, rectal cancer. And then we're also developing some registries to put the patients that don't quite fit into those protocols, those pilot studies, trying to interrogate a large number of patients. And so when you do these signatures, you have to collect a great volume of data and then validate the signatures that you create that says this patient's gonna do well with this therapy, this patient's gonna need more therapy, this patient is gonna need a drug, this patient should have surgery, et cetera. And so the pilot data is nice because it's longitudinal. What you'll do is you'll just heavily interrogate a given patient with all sorts of tests. They could be imaging tests like PET scans or MRIs. They could be blood tests. They could even be re-biopsies. And then once we develop the idea of a signature that we think is prognostic, then we test it against the registry, which includes huge volumes of patients, and validate it to make sure. And we'll, of course, use artificial intelligence to do that type of validation.
Thank you for your question, Wendy. So I'm gonna go back and read Subar Yudu's question. And it looks like the question is, what has your experience been with the use of artificial intelligence and or machine learning? Were there any surprises on its effectiveness or on limited effectiveness?
It's mostly been limited effectiveness, I hate to say. And I think it's been sort of a technique in search of a problem. At least in medicine, the use of artificial intelligence has not been game-changing to date. But machines are always good at doing tasks that are either very mundane, but big volumes of them, or tasks where it's hard to see patterns. And so in this particular application that I tried to describe to you, where we have a lot of information, maybe relevant, maybe not relevant, related to each patient's course along the way, I personally think this is one of the best applications for artificial intelligence. And hopefully it will prove that this is where artificial intelligence could actually change what we do. And make a treatment better and change the standard of care. But it's sad that so far artificial intelligence is great at chess, but it hasn't been so great at changing things in medicine to date anyway.
Thank you again for the question. George, it looks like you have a question in the chat. If you want to unmute and ask your question, please feel free.
Yeah, I was wondering whether there's any synergy or symbiosis between PULSAR and flash therapy in the sense that, you know, is PULSAR potentially a poor man's flash, or could the two therapies be combined together, or how do they relate? I mean, how might they relate to one another?
Okay, so first I'm gonna explain to the group what flash is. Flash is a type of radiotherapy that's given at such a fast dose rate that it damages the tissue that it hits in a very different way than it would have if it had been given at a slower dose rate. And people have likened it to sort of a neutron bomb that can destroy things in a building but not destroy the building. And so normal tissues seem to tolerate flash surprisingly well, and tumors seem to hate it. And it's under investigation. There's not a lot of machines that can generate flash. By the way, a cyclotron, like a proton therapy machine, might be able to do it. But PULSAR is radiation agnostic. Somebody asked me earlier about protons versus photons, and you could do PULSAR with any form of radiation. It could be flash, it could be protons, it could be photons, it could be brachytherapy. That doesn't matter. What matters is that you allow the intervals between for change to occur. Now, some people may not like the idea that we're purposely waiting to finish a treatment. You know, some people say, I just want to get it over with and get on with my life. But if we can prove to you that your therapy will be far more personalized, just enough therapy to cure you, not excessive amounts of therapy, but making sure you have enough therapy to cure the patient. And I think that if we explain this to patients, that it might take 3 months to finish the treatment, but you won't be here for but a few days out of each month. I think that the patients will understand that and prefer that over one size fits all therapy.
Thank you for the question. Thank you, Dr. Timmerman. I'm probably going to butcher this, so I apologize in advance, but Suprabha submitted a question and mentioned that they are also experiencing audio issues. So the question is, do you need to restage patients before each pulsar?
Not restage. You only stage a patient once, and that's up front. So that's staging is a prognostic determination based on presentation of a patient. So if a patient has cancer that has spread to the lymph nodes, they're going to be stage three. If they have a cancer that spread to the other organs, they're going to be stage four. And but PULSAR is going to interrogate very carefully with imaging and all the kinds of studies you do to stage somebody, but it won't be to restage them. They'll remain in the stage they are. We'll just use that information to personalize the therapy along the way.
Great, thank you. And there's a question from David. I think it's gonna be a popular one among patients. David, if you are here and want to unmute and ask your question, please feel free. It looks like David might have joined us via phone, so I will ask it on his behalf. Is PULSAR covered by major insurance plans at this point?
Our position, and somebody asked also, why haven't we been doing this before? And the course of radiotherapy is still going to be delivered. And so radiotherapy is a standard treatment. We consider PULSAR a standard treatment, a standard of care treatment. And so our position is that insurance companies should pay for it because radiotherapy is a standard treatment for cancer. Now, how we deliver that radiotherapy is between the doctor and the patient. And for example, if you took chemotherapy and the chemotherapy is FDA approved to be given one cycle every 6 weeks, you still can delay a cycle because your counts haven't recovered. In other words, it's up to the patient and the doctor to decide how fast or slow you give that standard therapy. And we're taking advantage of a degree of freedom that we've never, we didn't think about it because we would just get our therapy over with like that was done in the standard days. But if you can have a big advantage for these delays between pulses, then it makes sense. And so our position is that this is standard of care. It should be covered by all legitimate insurance companies. And it's, again, between the patient and the doctor, how fast or slow they give the treatment.
Awesome, thank
you. And so far it's been covered without difficulty.
Awesome. Ryan, it looks like you had a question in the chat. If you want to unmute and ask your question, please do.
Hi, Dr. Timmerman. You kind of answered my question previously, so I'll revise it. With preclinical data and kind of in the era of SAbR Comet, do you postulate or kind of anticipate that the potential abscopal effect, this kind of immune adaptation, to be less profound in a more allele-progressive or metastatic state?
Okay, so SAbR Comet was a clinical trial originated in Canada, ended up being a multinational trial done in Europe, US, and Canada. And it showed that in patients with metastatic cancer, that treating the metastatic tumors with more than just a drug to add a local therapy, like in this case, SAbR, would improve their survival. And I don't think it's so surprising because the biggest problem with drug therapy is tumors that you already have. It's better at avoiding new tumors from forming, but it always struggles with gross disease. So this trial showed a benefit by adding SAbR to this. That SAbR was given every day or every other day, just like SAbR has been given now for the last couple of decades. PULSAR is trying to be more elegant at understanding the immune cascades that would occur that would make the immune therapy more effective. So for example, if you give the treatment every day or every other day, it's very likely that you're killing the immune cells that are coming back from the lymph nodes back into the tumor to try to kill the tumor. So you're almost shooting yourself in the foot with that second dose. And by waiting 10 days in our preclinical experiences. Now, all of a sudden, and I'm not sure exactly what cells exactly we're killing with a second treatment, but it's become very clear to us that there is some part of the immune cascade that's being disrupted by giving the treatments in too close a proximity to each other. And so this abscopal effect, that is to treat one tumor and other tumors that you didn't treat shrink, requires an immune system to function. And we think that PULSAR functions with the immune system similar to a vaccine and booster shots, where you let the all these cascades play out before you come in again and try to create a new vaccination. Great. Did I explain that okay?
Ryan, did that answer your question?
Yes. Essentially, you kind of postulate that we're unsure and there likely may not be limitations based on disease burden, that we kind of just have to play it out and see how it effectively interacts with the immune system.
Right. So that's the next step. I mean, we did observational studies that I showed you a little glimpse of some of the preclinical studies that were purely observational. I don't know what the mechanisms, why PULSAR worked and daily treatments didn't work, but that's what we hypothesize. We hypothesize that we're killing some cell that would have been otherwise important in affording a better immune response.
Awesome, thank you. I am gonna call on Mary. Mary, if you wanna unmute and ask your question.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so I was wondering that if PULSAR doesn't require new technology, why hasn't it been used before?
I think it's partly driven by payment systems. In other words, if you finish the course of therapy, the doctor will get paid sooner. And then it's also partly just laziness. I mean, or not laziness, but not being willing to change. And with conventional radiotherapy, if you took advantage of the degree of freedom to spread out the treatments, you got penalized with the tumor growing during the break. But with SAbR treatments, there doesn't seem to be such a penalty, at least for at least 3 months or so. And so I think the reason we haven't done it before is for no good reason. And now that we have a therapy that can hold a tumor in check while other cascades and other opportunities for it to shrink could play out, this is, you're right. There's no new technology that makes PULSAR unique. We've already developed SAbR, and now we're just using SAbR more effectively, I think.
Awesome, thank you. Jennifer, if you want to unmute and ask your question, please do.
I had CyberKnife treatment on my C3, and I was just curious about the difference between PULSAR technology and the CyberKnife technology.
Yeah, so again, we're agnostic. So we're doing PULSAR with the CyberKnife. The CyberKnife is an irradiator that is highly focused. It's incredibly precise. It images in almost real time to make sure that there's no movement during a treatment session. And so the CyberKnife would be a perfect platform to do PULSAR on. Now, many times the CyberKnife is a stereotactic irradiator that's akin to the Gamma Knife. And these are often done in one treatment. And one treatment is a good way to approach it. It's very convenient and it lets people get on with either other therapies or their life. The trouble with one treatment is it doesn't allow you to adapt. You give a treatment and it'll be one size fits all as in the past. So we're excited about PULSAR because it gives us this opportunity to adapt. And most of the CyberKnife treatments are one treatment, not all, but most of them are. That has its limitations.
Thank you.
And then we've got a question from Courtney in the chat. Courtney, if you'd like to unmute and ask your question, please go ahead. Let's see. As you say, I can always ask it too. For people in rural communities, does PULSAR offer a shorter, more effective treatment option?
Yeah, we're not thinking that PULSAR will probably ever be more than 5 pulses. So years ago, we had a grant from the Department of Defense, and they were interested in, you know, helping their veterans, especially the ones that were still on military assignment, get treatments that were more feasible. So standard treatment was 39 daily treatments of radiotherapy, really hard. And, you know, you almost have to focus on that. It would take 9 to 10 weeks to finish it. And so we got this grant to look at 5 or fewer treatments for prostate cancer. And that's led into a big change in the paradigm, where patients now are routinely getting 5 or fewer treatments for their prostate cancer. In rural, people from rural areas, this is awesome, because if they have to make trips to a big city to get a therapy like that, it's not going to do them in as far as their livelihood. And so now the only difference between those treatments, which were again done every other day for 5 treatments, so it took about 2.5 weeks to finish the whole course of therapy, we would be spacing those 5 treatments out over a couple months, you know, maybe 3 to 4 months. But again, the patient would not be coming here except for 1 day out of each month. And I think that's a reasonable trade-off, especially if we can personalize it, because again, the old SAbR 5 treatments was one size fits all.
Awesome. We've got one more question before we close everything out. And it came through, I think, ahead of time from our friend Renee. What are the complications, short and long-term side effects of PULSAR treatment?
Well, they're going to be less than the same dose given in the more standard SAbR way. In other words, it's hard to fathom that a PULSAR treatment would ever be more toxic than a standard SAbR treatment, which is given every other day. And I think we've not only proven that with the old randomized trials, but even the more recent randomized trials. So the side effects hopefully will be considerably less, because if the tumor shrinks, then there's less normal tissue that will be touching the tumor when it's treated, at least for the subsequent pulses. And I can't quantify it for you yet, but we in general are assuming that PULSAR is going to be less toxic. There are circumstances where we may have to escalate the intensity of the treatment, because otherwise the patient's going to die of cancer. And then I guess the toxicity could go up, but that's good to know that you need to intensify the treatment if somebody has a real resistant tumor. And then the patient can weigh out the pros and cons of accepting the more intensive treatment. But there are going to be a lot of people who are going to need less treatment. Instead of doing 5 treatments, we'll only do 3. Because their response was so impressive. And that's also going to reduce toxicity.
Awesome. Well, we appreciate everybody's questions this evening, and I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Jenny to close us out. Thank you, Dr. Timmerman, for answering everybody's questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Mindy. And indeed, thank you, Dr. Timmerman. This was fascinating, and to see how this next generation of precision medicine is enhanced by AI, it's really incredible. It's great for patients. So thank you for sharing with us. I do want to thank my colleagues, Mindy, for helping with Q&A, and Charlandra for helping with hosting duties, and also our friend Claire Almanza in Dr. Timmerman's department for helping prepare us for the Science Cafe. And to everyone here tonight, thanks for joining us. We hope you enjoyed this latest edition of UT Southwestern Science Cafe. Please join us again Thursday, May 20th at 7 p.m. with Dr. Andy Siss, who will be presenting about mental health treatment advancements. And his work also has a technology angle, which is kind of interesting. And of course, I have to share that our parting message tonight is to get the shot. For those who have questions regarding the COVID vaccines and the virus itself, please visit us at utswmed.org/COVID-19. and get your questions answered. We have FAQs all over the place and videos you can watch, but also while on the website, click on that yellow vaccination bar at the top of the page and you can register to get your shot. We are now offering same day and next day appointments in many cases, which is exciting. And who knows, maybe starting next week, we'll have some kids getting vaccinated with some advancements there. Also, even if you are vaccinated, we still need to utilize NPIs, non-pharmacological interventions, such as wearing masks, social distancing, and continued vigilance with hand hygiene. We want to get us back to that new normal. But for now, we are adjourned. We wish you good health, good spirits, and a good rest of your evening. Thank you.